The 2015 Polyglot Gathering is brought to you by iTalki. Become fluent in any language.
여러분 안녕하십니까? 안녕하십니까? 답하이 하루 답을 하루 라이 고소죠? 삼세죠? Okay. I'm going to try to do 10 languages in 50 minutes. Sorry. I was told that at 10 minutes to 12, if you want to leave, fine, but I could go a little bit over. Okay, so if you want to stay, because I don't know if I can get through it all. But what I'm going to do is there's a lot of information here, but I'm just going to give you the main points, and then at question time, if you had questions, we can deal with those. But basically, the goal is to, okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah. So I just want to say that this talk can go over a little bit to give him a little extra time. So.
Oh. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Here you go.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay. So as you see, the goals here is basically to introduce you to the language. If you're interested, if you haven't learned any languages in Asia, I say languages in Asia because they aren't Asian languages. It's not a group. There's various groups here. That maybe this presentation will help you in deciding. Okay, so first I'd like your cooperation. I'm going to now play some music from the 10 languages. So when you hear the song, if you can recognize the language, could you kind of do this? If you speak it pretty well, this. If you're fluent, put it your hand. Is that okay? So I can get an idea where everybody's at. Okay, let's start.
Soundtrack filem Nur Kasih dan Syah harap anda semua akan suka dengan versi Syah sebab Syah tahu apa yang T. Zakir dan Yasin nyanyikan tu memang dah sudah pun tersemat dalam jiwa setiap dari kita termasuk diri Syah. So hope anda semua suka.
An old song, but Japanese.
I'm sorry.
dependent. Okay. So we had, what was it, Thai, then followed by Lao, and then what do I have next? Thai, Lao, I forget the order, Chinese, Korean, then Vietnamese, then Japanese, and then, yeah, Bahasa Indonesia and Bahasa Malay, and then Hindi and Nepali. Okay, so basically here in this chart, I'm giving you an overview. I think one of the important or interesting aspects is if you learn these 10 languages, you can speak with one-third of the world population. Now, that's mainly due to Hindi, languages like Hindi, obviously, and Chinese, and Indonesian, and Malay. The next interesting thing is that, well, there are different groups represented here, and then I'll talk about them in their groupings and their similarities. You have subject, object, verb in case of four, and the rest are subject, verb, object. There's four tonal languages, and the noun inflections, just some in Nepali and Hindi. Okay, verb conjugations, only in these four again, or in other words, it's interesting that Japanese, Korean, and Hindi, Nepali share some of the same characteristics, but there's no relationship between them. There's no verb conjugation in Japanese or Korean according to first, second, third person, though. So far as definite articles, none, okay? Very different than a lot of European languages, like Slavic languages. Then for plurals, okay, the concept of plural is very different than in European languages, and usually not necessary, but you can make plurals in inanimate plurals in Korean and Hindi and Nepali to just by using haru. If you double the noun, you get a plural, but it's not the same meaning as a plural as it would be in a European language. It has different meanings. For example, in Indonesian Malay, it has three different types of meanings. Usually, it's like a collective. Okay, then postpositions in these four languages again. And what I'll show interesting is no relative pronouns in these three languages. Okay, no that, which, where, etc. Okay, so what about difficulty of writing? So what's the most difficult language in the world to write? Beyond a doubt, Japanese, okay? Then maybe followed by Chinese or Thai or Lao, or depends how you look. I think Nepali and Hindi are quite easy. They're using the same Devanagari. Of course, in this group, the easiest would be, as Obama is saying, he has some experience in Indonesian, the Bahasa, because it's very phonetic, okay? We'll get to questions later. Okay. Now, yeah, I can't take questions. Okay, now get ready. Okay, start. Okay, once you get used to it, this is not hard to do. Okay, we're just creatures of habits. It goes, why don't you separate? Okay? All right, these languages don't separate. And Thai and Lao don't use any punctuation at all, okay? What's interesting is that Korean separates. It has rules for separation. So if Japanese wanted to separate, they could follow the Korean way of separation because I'll show you later, grammatically, structurally, they're very similar. What about the writing system, the characters? Look at Chinese. Basically, nowadays you have the traditional characteristics, the mainland, China, simplified, and then the Japanese simplified after the war. Sometimes the Japanese simplified characters are similar to the traditional, and sometimes they're similar to the Chinese simplified. Now, I don't like simplified characters. I don't like gentitsa, okay? And one of the reasons is this. You get it? This is the sun. This is a tree. When the sun's behind a tree, you have east. This is the simplified character. No sun, no tree. Okay, so why is Japanese the hardest? Well, you at least need to know 2,000 characters to get through high school, maybe 3,000, 4,000 throughout life, and then you have two alphabets or syllables to deal with. Okay, and but the real problem is here. In Chinese, some characters have multiple pronunciations, okay? This is 多音字. But usually only a few, like, for example, 银行 and 行不行. Now look, this is just one character, 生 in Chinese. Look at all the possible pronunciations in Japanese. So how do I read it? You have to look at the context. Even somebody's name, you won't know how to read it sometimes. The name Yamato and Daiwa are written exactly the same way. Okay? All right. Now, some people, Japanese people, talk about, oh, yeah, you know, we write characters. We can read, you know, Chinese or the Chinese. Okay, here's the story. Take a look at this sentence, all right? The sentence means, what is this? Simple sentence, right? Okay, 这是什么东西? So I've written in simplified, which is hard to read for Japanese anyway, and the traditional. But the Japanese look at that, and the only thing they see here is, why do you have East and West together? And then the Chinese look at this, and they say, oh, I don't know, you know, hiragana, what does that mean, you know? Or they see, okay, that's something to do with what? All right, but you can write it either way in Japanese. All right, now a Chinese person looking at this sentence in Japanese, you have to take away this is, of course, if they haven't studied Japanese. Okay, you have to take away the kana, so they're only looking at the characters, and they might get 60 to 90% of the meaning here. In this case, they'll probably get 100% because it's just talking about Kyoto University's program. Okay, so it's very straightforward. It's not really a sentence. It's more like a name. Okay, so no problem. But here is a Chinese sentence, and Japanese looking at it. Here is the simplified. Here's traditional. So either way, Japanese are not going to get the meaning. Maybe 20%, maybe 30%. They're basically not going to understand it. All right. Now, there's also. Can we say they're false cognates? There are characters with different views in a different way, and sometimes it's quite comical. Okay, for example, in Japan, when you go to the onsen, when you go to hot springs, you have this. Okay, this is the men's bath, here's men, and here's hot water, and the woman's bath. But Chinese comes and sees this, and what do they think? Oh, men's soup, a female soup? Or the Chinese person comes to Japan, and they see a post box. So, shorts? I put my toilet paper here? On the letter? Huh? Cut my hand? Here, Japanese, if it was written, he's in pain. He's enduring something. Chinese, huh? Woma, I'm slow. I'm slow? It's the only meaning you get out of that. Here's the opposite. In China, they're talking about this Japanese car. But in Korean, this is the same way as in Japanese. Okay, so you can get false cognates. It's an interest when you're using characters. The idea of cognates becomes very interesting. Okay, all right. Now let's take a look at some of the other writing systems. Here we have Korean. They use jamo, which this hangul system or chosungul in is the name in North Korea. Was invented in 1443. Basically, you have sound units, and they're broken up into three parts. Okay, so here we have a list. We have 14 consonants here on the top and 10 vowels on the bottom. It doesn't include double consonants, etc. You could make this chart much, much bigger if you wanted to. But here's the basics of it for writing Korean. Now, there's an interesting similarity between Korean and Thai in this case, and that these consonant sounds have to reduce when they become the last sound of a syllable. Okay, so in Korean, they reduce to 7 sounds. All these reduce to these 7 sounds, all the consonants. Okay, Vietnamese. As I'll show you later, Vietnamese used to be written using Chinese characters, but they changed them a lot to make a special Vietnamese-style characters, Chitanom or Nom. Now, out of all these 10 languages, people say, which is the hardest language? I say, okay, grammatically or pronunciation. First, Chinese is difficult. Then I learned Thai. Oh, Thai. Well, Thai is much more difficult than Chinese. And then I learned Vietnamese. Okay? So here's your basic sounds, but then you have special letter combinations, and I'll show you later. This pronunciation of these depends whether you're living in Hanoi or Saigon. Okay? They have multiple diphthongs and triphthongs with all special sounds, and sometimes non-native speakers at first cannot hear the differences between what these sounds represented here, so it's definitely a challenge. Okay, now let's take a look at Thai. The Thai has 44 consonants, 21 initial consonants, and 6 final. Okay, so they all reduce. All right, an R becomes the sound of an N, an S becomes the sound of a T, which is exactly the same in Korean. Okay, so they have to be reduced when it's the final sound. Here you have your 32 vowels. Okay, so if you like vowels, learn Thai. Or Vietnamese, it's much, much more challenging there. Okay, so Lao and Thai are very similar, as we'll see. The Lao alphabet is also, of course, very similar. Here you can see the two lined up together. But the Lao has just 20, Lao is simplified. What Thai tries to capture what the pronunciation originally was in the language it's coming from. So they have a mark to show, hey, you don't pronounce this, we're just putting this here because this is Pali. But you don't say it, okay? And so Lao also just has 28 vowels instead of 32. Okay. Now, tones. Let's get into tones. Yes, you can. The tones in Thai are expressed in the written form, but it's not easy, okay? So I won't go through all this now because it takes a long time to explain. I saw Benny. Benny made this video where he's telling people how to simplify it. I saw comments from some people who think that, no, that's too simplified way of thinking about it, but I thought it was pretty good. I don't really bother with it too much, trying to get the tones from reading. I can read and write Thai. I just do it from the feeling. You know, I've heard it enough, so I know what the tone is. Okay, so you can see that the diacritics for tonal marks in Thai and Lao are very similar. Okay, now we'll get into Devanagari. So this is used to write Hindi, Nepali, Gujarati, yeah, a few others, okay. What's interesting is, I'll get to that later, sorry. You have some additional consonants that are only used in the case of loan words, and then you have some common conjunct consonants. Okay, then you can put consonants together, they double up, or not even the same consonant, I mean different consonants or the same consonants doubled, and you shorten it when you stick it to the next one. Okay, here are the vowels. The vowels are written this way when they come at the beginning of a word, so they're free. And then when you combine it with a consonant, you have to change form. Okay, so This is, you write nothing, okay? It's just assumed sound of ah. Here it's a longer sound, this is a long A, and you write it. Okay, so this is how they transform. Now what's interesting is that you can represent all the sounds in Devanagari, basically, close enough, using Thai, but not the other way around, because Thai has more sounds. Okay, the tones. So probably most everybody knows, they say, okay, Mandarin has four tones. Well, if you say that this the neutral is not a tone, then you have to reduce the number of tones in Vietnamese and Thai when they talk about it. I don't know why people say, you know, Mandarin only has four tones because they don't count this, but they count this neutral tone in Vietnamese and in Thai. In Vietnamese, the tones are clearly marked. It's very easy to learn how to read the tones. I mean, 10 minutes, you got it. Not that you got how to pronounce it, but you know how to read it, okay? Here's the Thai tone pitches. The tones are quite different, even though it's rising and falling, et cetera. They are different between these languages, and I'll give you an example on a video coming up here. Here we have the Lao tones. Some people say there's five, some people say there's six. It depends which dialect. There are many dialects of Lao. Okay, let's listen to the tones here. Notice how using M-A, but notice the A in Vietnamese with no marks, it's a different sound, right? Okay. All right, now tongue twisters. We did a lot of tongue twisters the first night here. I said, okay, let's do a Vietnamese tongue twister or something. No, no, no. Okay. A Thai tongue twister.
We had no native speakers.
Yes. You have Vietnamese? You weren't here the first night, I guess, yeah. Okay, so the tones are also are a big part of the tongue twister. Chinese. Mother's writing. What's wrong?
Mama, chi ma, ma an, mama, ma
ma.
I'm one
Vietnamese.
Oh, sorry. What did I do here? Oh, sorry about that. Sorry, I think I hit it. Okay, you want to try that? Anybody, any volunteers there? Would you like to try that? Okay. Now, can something happen when you get the tone wrong? All right. I teach at a Japanese university in Japanese, but I have a lot of Chinese students there and Vietnamese students, etc. And in my first year students, his last name was this, Cao, and I accidentally said it in the fourth tone. The F word. Okay? When you drop the tone, it's not the same as Cao. Okay? All the Chinese students. I didn't make that mistake again. Okay, so let's take a look here. Which, if you wanted to learn one of these languages, where do you start? Okay, I mean, how are they similar to one another? Because the Japanese and the Koreans and the Chinese their writing system started by writing Chinese. There are many, many Chinese loan words in these languages, okay? There are various estimates, 30 to 60%, depending on the language. So here are just examples. Now, if you know the Chinese characters, if you learn Chinese first, and you know how the sound transforms, then you can guess how to say something. You're not always right, and sometimes, because the characters are often used differently. But okay, for example, here for telephone, so you have 电话, 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 中话, okay? So I don't know if those sound similar to you, all right? But once you get used to these changes, then yeah, you know, it will help you, okay? So just to give a clear idea, spoken Chinese, Vietnamese, and Korean are not mutually intelligible, even for a polyglot. Oh, I speak great Chinese, so now I'm going to speak Japanese or Korean. No, you have to study it first. You have to know the differences. Okay, so if you know Korean, easy to learn Japanese, or vice versa. Why? Vocabulary, syntax, grammatical particles, cultural similarities. I'll talk about that. The rest of relationships are just based on the fact that you're using, you know, you have the Chinese characters. Now the Koreans don't write in use many characters anymore, especially in the north. And in I guess most Vietnamese can't read characters, right? So nowadays. Okay, so in order to get an idea, well, we first heard the languages, but let's play a little bit more music. And everybody knows this song, to see how different these languages sound. Okay, so you can see that spoken language, you know, even though you have all those words, maybe 40% of the words said here are originally from Chinese. But unless you study it some, you won't be able to understand it. Okay, so let's take a closer look at the similarities between Japanese and Korean. And this is my own view. Okay, just from my experience, and I picked out what I thought was quite interesting in this sense. Its first thing is that both languages basically had three levels of politeness. Now, this is much more complicated than any European language, okay? Because the way the different words that you have to use. I think what's happened here is my slides, the formatting has gone way off here. Okay, so you have a plain or informal level, which basically just using the verb to do, suru in Japanese, and he in Korean. That's the lowest level. Now, Korean actually, as I say here, has seven levels, but you can combine these together. They're based on how you use the verb hada, the verb to do. But you can combine them into three. You have normal politeness level. When Japanese, you're using shimasu, and then in Korean, you're using heseyo or hamnida. And then you have your high-level speech, which involves using honorifics, etc. Okay, so in Japanese, just, what time you'll come? I'll come at 11. All right, your lowest level, your mid, second level, and highest level. So this is nanji kuru, juichi ni kuru. 何時に行きますか? あ、11時に行きます。 何時お入りになるでしょうか? What time are you coming? Same thing. 11時に参ります。 Okay? So, completely different, all right? It's not taking a verb and just, you know, different form of the verb like, you know, ¿A qué hora vienes? Yo vengo, you know, ¿Usted quiere viene? Or something like that, like in Spanish. Okay, so you have here your honorific language, humble language, and polite languages, and how the verbs are actually quite different in each one. I just gave the example of to do, suru, sareru. So this is the highest form. So this verb becomes sareru nasaru, okay? And this is humble language when you're talking about yourself. And then this is just mid-politeness level. So it gets a little bit complicated. All right, now, Korean does the exact same thing. Korean verbs also change according to the level that you're speaking. For example, the Japanese common word to eat is 食べる. But 召し上がる is being polite. So when you go to a restaurant, they're going to say 召し上がる. They're not going to use the verb 食べる. And then just like in Korean, you have 먹다, in Japsurida, and the suida. Okay? All right, now, taking a further look in here in Japanese, where we have the difference between the respectful, you have keigo, kenjogo, and teirego. Okay, so it depends whether you're talking about yourself, the second person, the other person, etc. Then you have to change what you say. For example, watashi, normal level, and then, sorry, this high level, and then watashi, normal level. So something something san becomes sama, all right? And then when you're saying, you know, that person over there, anohito, becomes achira sama. Okay, so completely different words that you have to use when you're speaking at the different levels of politeness. I'm getting some blank stares. Okay, I'm just giving you an introduction here. You know, it's not to remember it or anything. Okay, so going further, nouns are that way too. Which noun do you use? All right, depends on what level you're speaking. Okay, so here, just saying year, you can say toshi, nen, nai in Korean. But when you're being polite, you have to change it. Otoshi and yonse in Korean, etc. Or just, you know, rice or food, gohan, pap, jinchi, or oshokuji is polite for food. Okay. Yes, it's confusing. All right, the second example. Now, this terminology is not official terminology. I just made it up, okay? I call them suridoshi or kanjidoshi. What it is Japanese and Korean take Chinese characters and they add the verb to do and it becomes a verb, okay? So, yakusoku suru, to make an appointment or to promise. And then you'll see that the Korean pronunciation is very similar, yakusokuhada, but the Chinese is very different, okay? And what I noticed is that the pronunciation of some of these characters in Korean and Japanese and Vietnamese is similar. Now, I was asking the person giving a presentation before why he thought so, and we had various opinions why that's, you had an opinion about why that is so. That person said because the Koreans and the Japanese and the Vietnamese borrowed the words from Middle Chinese. I think it's I always had the feeling it's because they're borrowing it from the southern dialects of Chinese, which sound more like these pronunciations, which you said, right? Yeah, as a southern speaker of southern dialect. Okay. Next example, how are they similar? These are the only two languages I know of. If anybody knows a different language, another language which uses this system of marking grammar, please tell me. These are not cases, okay? These are not cases. Japanese and Korean are topic languages. You introduce a topic, then the subject, and go on from there. You have markers for the direct object. You have markers for the indirect object, etc. Okay, and they're topic languages. So when Japanese are learning English, like if you said, like, where are you from? You say, oh, I'm from Tokyo. And the other person says, oh, I'm Fukuoka. In English, it sounds, they might be trying to say it in English, you know. The topic is where you're from, so they just got, they're not saying, I'm from Fukuoka. That's redundant. I am Fukuoka. It would be in English, right? That's in their head, okay? So once you have the topic, it's you don't have to introduce all these things again. But if you want to change the topic, Chunin, not you, but I, then you throw back in this topic marker, or watashi wa, and then it changes the focus. Okay, so basically these functions, there are some differences, but these particles exist in both languages and use a very similar way. Okay, next is like the English to be, when you're expressing the nature of something, like kore wa hon desu, this is a book. In Korean, you also have, you'll use imnida, but when you're talking about the location of something, in Japanese you use arimasu, aru. In Korean, they use isimnida, and so they same in this way. But Japanese distinguishes between animate and inanimate in this case. So you have imasu and arimasu. Arimasu is for things. Okay. Now I once corrected a Japanese person who said gakusei, soyu gakusei ga arimasu. I mean that type of student exists, and they use this one. I said, huh? I said, isn't it imasu? Oh, sumimasen. So, I make a lot of mistakes, but sometimes I realize, you know, theirs. All right. Okay, so, and then other aspects of verb behavior. now, both languages, they inflect. You know, there's changes in the verbs, okay? But they don't, the verbs don't change to indicate singular or plural, like in Spanish, or first person, second person, third person. Or to indicate gender, like in Hindi or Slavic languages, none of that. So he's, oh, maybe it's easy. Nope. So what I've done here, and I won't read all these, okay? We can go back to them later and talk about it if we have time. What I've done here is just to show you all the concepts that can be expressed just by inflecting the verb, okay? So it's all, the verb comes at the end, and in Korean and Japanese, you're inflecting it to give all these different meanings. Basically, in Japanese and Korean, there's a non-past. Okay, English is the same. There's really no present tense in English. It's just non-past. It's habitual, right? And then there's past. But there's many things that you express with modal verbs in English and other languages. Okay, so the present, presumptive, you know, would do something, imperative. Past indicative, must have, past presumptive, present progressive is also, you can say that. Past progressive, what else? Conditional, potential, make somebody do something. Passive, now passive gets very complicated and it's often used to make things very polite. So I would need a couple days to explain that one. And also I would need some experts in Japanese language to try to figure the whole thing out. Okay. So, what's interesting is you could say that Korean has no adjectives because they're all verbs. When you look up an adjective in a dictionary Korean, the ending is the same as a verb ending. Okay? So, this ta ending. Now, Japanese is not exactly like that, but Japanese verbs also conjugate or inflect, okay? And so it has a descriptive form in Korean using the un, so a pretty flower, a flower that was once pretty, a flower that will be pretty, okay? You're conjugating the adjective. You're inflecting the adjective. Or for example, like this. この映画は面白いですね. This is interesting movie, okay? So Jamie, ipta, you're using the same thing. You can take the ipta, you can make a past tense, or this one, or here, it was so interesting, that's something, et cetera, et cetera. There's so many ways that the adjective are going to change in order to express different meanings. That would be expressed with verbs in English. Okay. Yes, maybe you're familiar with what Mark Twain said here. About German having the verb coming at the end. Okay. Now, of these six languages, there's four languages where it's subject-object-verb. All right? Now, the other six languages are not. So you think, oh, yeah, sometimes Japanese people say to me, they say, oh, yeah, Chinese, you know, just like English, it's subject, verb, object. It must be very similar in grammar. Nope. No way. And one of the biggest reasons is the lack of relative pronouns. So everybody know Mother Goose, the house that Jack built? In English, you just keep it, add that, and you can basically follow it, right? Even 10 minutes, you still get the idea. Oh, try that in a language that doesn't have relative pronouns. So I change it to something simple, and I check my Malay with Brian. Thank you, Brian. I can show you Malay at the end. But here it is in Japanese. Okay, so what do you have to do? There's no relative pronoun, so you have to make that phrase that comes after relative pronoun like an adjectival phrase and throw it in the front. Okay? Yeah? Okay, so if we jump down to the bottom here, to like when I'm saying, this is the man who works at the store where I bought the pen that I used to write the letter that I wrote. Is that okay? In English, it's okay, right? Easy, follow it quickly. Okay, in Japanese, then you say, yeah, ah, kore wa watashi ga kaita tegame o kaku tame ni tsukatta pen o katta mise de hatoraiteru hito desu. Now, in English, it would look something like this. This I wrote letter to write used pen bought store at working man is. Because these are working man at the store, working, you see? Takes some getting used to, all right? I just expose you the first time. But without relative pronouns, you get this. But you get the same in Chinese. So I sometimes I teach a lot of Chinese students, especially, I teach management, I don't teach language. I teach international management, cross-cultural management in Japanese and often in Chinese. My graduate students are from China. So sometimes we don't bother with Japanese, we use Chinese. Sometimes somebody else, like a Vietnamese or a Japanese in the classroom, so we have to say, okay, oh, enough of the Chinese, let's say what is in Japanese so they can understand. And then the Chinese will, because it's something difficult. They speak Japanese well, but now they have to translate an idea. And I said, wait a second, just think this way. Because they don't even realize they're doing the same thing in Chinese at times. In Chinese, you do it just using a de, okay? So when you go beyond this last sentence here, I would say Chinese speakers, wouldn't you say it would get difficult to go any further? Yeah. All right, so Chinese won't make these relative pronoun that sentences very often because it would get very confusing, okay? So you have 这是在我买信用的港币的商店里工作的人, okay? So this I buy write letter use pen store in working man. And the only difference between Japanese is the is here instead of it's here. So is Japanese similar to Chinese similar to Japanese or English in structure? Okay, now there are some differences in Chinese which are, you know, make it quite different than both languages, obviously. Okay, here it is in Bahasa Malaysia. It would be more or less the same in Indonesian. Basically, you have yang, you can use tempat when it's for where, di tempat or di mana or things like that. And it's no problem. Like here you have ini laki yang bekerja kedai di mana aku membeli pen yang aku ganukan untuk menulis surat yang aku sudah tulis. Okay? So this man that work in store where I buy pen, I use to write letter that I wrote. It's not so bad. It's kind of like English, right? So that's a big difference. Okay, let's move on to more about Vietnamese. The interesting thing about Vietnamese, you see this area in red? That's where the native speakers are, the people who speak the Vietnamese people who, or just like when you talk about Chinese, say Hang Ren, you know, the Chinese people, not the minorities, okay? This other area is all minority, mainly, okay? So Vietnamese is not the mother tongue of most of the people who live in this white area. So there are three major dialects. You have the north, you have the south, and you have the central. And I'll get back to that in a minute. And I mentioned that Vietnamese used to write in Chinese, okay? This chữ nôm, And this is what it looked like. Some of these characters do not exist in Chinese in this form. They are changed in order to express Vietnamese. Okay? Okay, in here I'm just giving you some examples. Was it Victor today said, who gave a presentation, said he wants to learn Vietnamese using Chit Ngôn? So he can. You can find it in places. Nobody's going to write it that way, but it helps you remember. Like, this is interesting. To say no, those who know Chinese means it's basically empty, right? Hung. So hung. But most Vietnamese don't know this, so they don't know it's coming from this, so it doesn't help with Chinese. But the no is basically saying empty, okay? And also I noticed that most of my Vietnamese students don't know how to write their last name in Chinese. But there's a Chinese character for every Vietnamese name. Okay, now, pronouns. I thought when I talk about these languages, I would talk a lot about pronouns. But I'll do a little bit about Vietnamese. But this is true of Vietnamese, Thai, Indonesian, Malay. Pronouns are very interesting, very complicated. The sentence, when you say, Ong di vien nha, Ong di vien nha, Ong di vien nha, could be, I go home, because I'm the grandfather. You, old man, grandfather, go home. It doesn't even have to be a relationship. Or, he goes home. This is totally ambiguous. Because a pronoun could be I, you, he, depends how it's used. And Thai people are very used to this too, doing the same thing. Thai people often use somebody's name all the time, especially, you know, women. When you talk about yourself, use your own name. Okay, so here are a number of pronouns which all represent relationships within the family. And they are more precise than they are in English. I mean, in English you would have to say, you know, my mother's older brother, you know, is that uncle is going to be different than your father's older brother, etc. Okay? So you would choose these according to the age of the person, your relative age of the person you're talking about. And this would be like an older brother, Ang. And these are often used in the case of, say, like a you for a man, Ang or Chi. I use this all the time because I'm older than all the Vietnamese people I talk to, so I always call them child, M. Now, it's interesting. I'll say M to them, and they'll answer back when they talk about themselves. They'll say M. Okay, you get it? Because I've made it, I said, you're M? Oh, yeah, I'm M. Okay? And then when I talk about, they'll say, Tay, Tay's our professor. And then when I talk about myself, I'll call myself Tay. Or I can say Doi, which is... That's one pronoun which kind of functions like European pronouns. We have all these that kind of function like European pronouns. A very common one is just saying friend, ban, ban di dao, where are you going, friend? More or less the same age and such, all right? Okay, let's look at the dialects, okay? I hope you can hear this. The sound system didn't work very well. That's why I'm using the mic here. First, we're going to have no... Oh, sorry. First, we're going to have Northern, and then we're going to have Southern, and then Central. Okay, so what's the big difference? Well, the Northern, they like fricatives. They like z, z. They like the z sound. There are many things that you write to pronounce z. D-A is pronounced za. And the G, like z, possibly, z. In the South, they like glides. So they would say ya, yoy. Okay, you'll be able to see what I'm talking about or hear what I'm talking about.
Tối nay đúng 8:30 nha. Tính em làm gì chứ? Đi chơi làm đúng giờ lắm á. Đừng để em chờ nha. Thôi về nha. Bye bye nha.
Ăn thì ăn, bán thì bán. Bộ ngồi đi ăn không coi sách hả? Mà mất cuốn nào tôi trừ lương anh.
Ừ. Sao kỳ vậy? Chính cô rủ tôi lên đây ngồi ăn cơm. Vậy nếu mất sách thì cô phải chịu sau đền tôi, đúng không?
Nói vậy thôi, ai dám lấy sách của tôi? Ai mà lấy sách của tôi chém á.
Cả chữ, cả tá, cả anh chị. Lúc con nhỏ, cũng như cả cô bé khác, Linh Đa đã mơ ước được là một hoa hậu Việt Nam. Vào mùa hè năm trước, mơ ước này đã trở thành sự thật. Một năm cũng đã trôi qua mau, Nhưng em sẽ không bao giờ quên cái hôm đi thi năm trước, hồi hộp.
Okay. So you could definitely see a big difference between the north and the south. And the central, you know, it's kind of in the middle, like in central. Okay, what am I going to talk about Vietnamese if we're not really actually trying to learn Vietnamese here, but just get an overview? I said, okay, let's look at the way they make questions because it's kind of interesting. First of all, there's no need to raise intonation at the end of the question when you form them like these, okay? They don't. When Japanese, the same way if you're using ka. Okay, ikimasu ka. You know. For example, here the ga is like have or exist, or sort of like have, let's say. And hong, no. Okay, so here you say, do you have something cheaper? Bango, gaingoi, zaahun, hong, that's northern. And then the answer back, ga, have, yes. The word for yes is vang, but you don't use it that much. You would just use, like, similar to Chinese, yo, meo, yo, okay? And hong, hong, ga. All right, so you can omit the ga if you want to, like talking about Bing, the short traveling. Bing, bingo, lam, yek, a gong, ti, zulik, hong. Okay, in the south, bingo, lam, yek, a gong, zulik, hong. And the next one is like when you're asking, have you done something yet? Or like you're saying like, banda ge hun che, are you married yet? This is a cultural thing. In Indonesia, in Malaysia, for example, you would say, if you say no, you're not married, you don't say no, you say belum. Belum, che, not yet. Of course I'm going to, but just not yet. Belum, 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 che, same in Thai. Young money. Okay.
It's funny talking to divorced people like that.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I was. Zai, Beza, home. Okay, so, and also you can ask affirmative questions using this Fai Hum, Go Fai Hum. So, Fai, if you say the answer is yes, you say Fai, Hum Fai. Okay, so also Fai is used when you're talking about a person, you know, it's a, Vietnam home. Oh, sorry. Engo phải là nơi Vietnam home. It's a home phải. No, I'm not. Okay, so you have to put the phải in there. Or you can use, this is another way to make questions. Let's how is it? Like, Dinh Viet Thế nào? And this is very true. Phát âm của Dinh Viet rất khó. Very difficult. Okay. Okay, so let's move on to Malaysian and Indonesian. So first, in Malaysia, multicultural society, you have 140 languages, okay? And there's many Chinese Malaysians. We have our Chinese Malaysian friends here. And so they could either be Cantonese, Mandarin, Hokkien, Hakka, Fuzhou, etc. Okay? There are 719 individual languages in Indonesia. So, you know, Bahasa Indonesia is like a lingua franca. It is a mother tongue of a number of people who don't learn their, you know, the dialects of their parents or the language of their parents. And the same way you have a lot of Chinese immigrants, mainly from the south. Okay, so comparing the two languages, they're both standardized isolects of Malay. They're originally both a Malay language. There are over 100 distinct Malay dialect isolects, okay, and they're characterized by mixing Malaysians and Indonesian words with vocabulary and syntax from their local languages. They're both influenced by Sanskrit words. Most words in Bahasa Malaysia are found in Bahasa Indonesia, not always the same meaning, but it's not the other way around, because Bahasa Indonesia has borrowed a lot of words from Dutch and local language, etc. Okay, the point is that which language should you learn, Indonesian or Malay? Well, if you learn Indonesian, it's easier to understand Malay. It's not a problem, but if you learn Malay, sometimes Indonesian is a little bit difficult to understand. But not much. I mean, you'll get most of it. It's just some small things which I'll try to show you. Okay, I've always, when I was in Indonesia, I always find foreigners coming there. Oh, Indonesian, so easy to learn. You know, the verbs are so simple. You know, there's no past tense or anything. Well, there's no past tense in Thai or Lao. You know, there's no inflections in six of these languages I'm talking about, okay? But actually, the verbs can be quite complicated because you have all these prefixes and suffixes that have different meanings, etc. Okay, so also another thing, these are showing, I left out the words which in one language is kind of nasty in the other language. There are a number of examples of that. These are more sanitized. I guess this would be the most common. Because when you say, bisa bicara bahasa Indonesia, I can speak, bisa bicara, I can speak Indonesian. But if you say that in Malay, it doesn't work because they boleh for, but boleh in Indonesian is like may I, you know. So bisa in Malay is venom, snake venom. It also is snake venom in Indonesia, but they realize that it also means, in this case, I can, you can, okay. Sometimes the words have opposite, you know, they're just switched. For example, police and policy. So in Malay, that's police and policy. In Indonesian, it's policy and police. Okay? So it's just switched. Okay, another thing is that you'll see most of these words are the same. The order is different. Now, Brian was saying in his dialect, they sometimes use this order. Okay? But so Malays will say, pagi besok, and then besok pagi. Pagi lusa, lusa pagi. Okay, and then sometimes they're different because here they have pagi semalam, they say kemarin pagi. Even though all these words exist in Indonesian, just the choice, the way that they're used. Okay, here are some examples of, I made a number of different sentences to show you where it's different. Okay, so you can see most of it's the same, right? The red part is different. And then I made the sentences that show some of the grammar. Okay, so you verbs do not conjugate for tense, so how do you know tense? Well, you could use sudah already, has already gone to the party, sudah pergi ke pesta, here pesta and party are the only differences here. You'll notice that, as Brian was saying to me, that the Malays more and more are dropping these prefixes. But the Indonesians use them. So menelepon is to call, and in Malaysia, telepon. Okay, so to indicate something completed, you might use, in the case of Malay, you're going to use sudah habis, but you're going to use selesai in Indonesian. You use habis in Malay, but it means there's no more. Ada no habis, it's all gone. Or like people like to say, finished. It's finished in Southeast Asia in English, yeah? All finished. Okay, so sudah to show a conditional action that's completed. And then you'll see that here the difference is berjumpa bertemu for to meet, okay? And then cik bapa cik instead of tua nona. Okay, here's some more examples. Again, the red shows the differences, bapa compared to bapa. Using belum, as I said before, belum is like a chưa in Vietnamese, not yet. Okay, so Mariam belum balik dari Brunei. Has she come back from, Mariam came back from Brunei, or kembali in the case of Indonesian. Okay, so you'll see if you learn one language, you'll understand a lot of the other one. Okay, now let's get to Pasa Thai. Okay, so now, Thai and Lao, of course you have to look at them together because they're almost the same language, more or less. But you have an interesting situation here because you have Thai, Isan, and Lao. What is Isan? The Northeast, basically. So what you have here is you have more speakers of, I would say that Isan is basically Lao. So you have more speakers of Lao in Thailand than you do of Laos, okay? Yeah. Okay, well, I will take it. I don't have time to go through all these, but you can see the difference here. I have Isan and Lao in Thai, okay? So here it would be, in Thai, when they use Mai, they use Bo in Lao, okay? Bo Dai, I can't, Mai Dai in Thai. So sometimes you'll see the Isan in Lao are exactly the same, but Thai is usually quite different. Okay. So how do you express tense and aspect in Thai? Well, many different ways. In the present tense, you can use the kam lang. In the future, you can use the word ja. And you, but it could also something that's just about to happen. You say kam lang ja set yu leo. It's just going to be done in a minute. I'm going to be done with this presentation in a minute. All right, I'm going to go really fast now. All right, so forming questions in Thai. I won't go into details here. Let me go. What would be the most important thing to take a look at? Okay, this is interesting, is that Thai sentence can sometimes be just a string of verbs, okay? Like this. So in this case, it would be, so I went to go back and sleep. But they're all just verbs strung together, all right? You don't need I or anything in there. Just string the verbs together. Okay, here I was just showing you differences between, I'm showing you difference between Lao and Thai. So here we see, for example, sabai di bo, which they use for, Thai people say sawadee krap, but the Thai says sabai di mai, but the Laos use sabai di bo also as a greeting that when you use sawadee krap in Thai. Okay. Okay, I love this, is that Thai language has a lot of heart phrases. Jai is kind of heart or spirit. And there are literally hundreds and hundreds of words using jai. What I like is, for example, is kao jai, understand, means enter the heart. Okay? And with the heart is conviction. Cold heart, you would think might be a cold person, no. Jai yin is jai yin, jai yin. When somebody's upset, oh, jai yin, jai yin. Be calm. Hot heart, you get angry very easily, okay? Henjai, you can see the heart, you're sympathetic. There's many interesting combinations that way. Should I play it? You want to hear Thai drama? I'm hooked on Thai dramas. Now, if you want to hear, I did this because there's three basically different registers here. A mother yelling at her daughter and her daughter yelling back without showing respect. And then the boss scolding, a man talk is made, the maid's very, ka, ka. Okay, all right, we'll go for it. Oh, sorry. She's not speaking
politely.
Speaking
politely.
งั้นเย็นนี้หนูไม่ต้องทำอาหารนะแต่ผมจะเข้าไปทำเองคุณพิสุทธิ์จะทำอาหารให้คุณกั้นทานเหรอคะได้เลยค่ะเดี๋ยวหนูจะเตรียมของสดเอาไว้ให้เลยนะคะคุณพิสุทธิ์มีอะไรอีกไหมคะไม่มีนะคะโอเคค่ะขอบคุณค่ะ
Daughter-in-law, the mother is very angry.
ในชีวิตฉันเนี่ยนะฉันกับลูกฉันไม่เคยทะเลาะกันเลยแม้แต่ครั้งเดียวจนกระทั่งฉันบอกเขาว่าคุณไม่มีทางทำให้ลูกฉันมีความสุขได้หรอกซึ่งเขาไม่เชื่อเขาไม่เชื่อเขายอมที่จะไปแต่งงานกับคุณแล้วผลลัพธ์เป็นยังไงผลลัพธ์เป็นยังไงไหนแล้วคุณอวดดีนะไงว่าคุณเนี่ย
She was saying that she's never argued with her son a whole life, only when he wanted to marry you. And I'd say, you would never give him happiness. Okay, where's his happiness? Show me, huh? Look. Okay, final part. Hindi and Malay. Hindi and Nepali. So, I just wrote this to show you. What is it? What does Nepali sound like to a Hindi? Okay. So as we were talking, I was speaking to you in Nepali this morning. It's kind of like a Dutch person listening to Afrikaans. Okay. or a Russian listen to Ukrainian, or you know, things like, or Bulgarian, you know, the grammars are different and such. Okay, so everybody, some facts about Hindi and Nepali. You know, a lot of people speak these languages. They use Devanagari. Nepali is also spoken in many places in India, Sikkim, okay, and Darjeeling area, even in Myanmar in certain areas, and also at restaurants in Europe that say Indian restaurants, okay. Yeah, in Bangkok, all over. You think, oh, Indian restaurant, and then you hear him if you can know the language, you hear him speaking Nepali. Okay? If they said Nepali food, who's going to go there? That's dal bhat. Okay? Only dal bhat. Dal and bhat. That's it. Rice and lentils. Okay. So this is the big difference between the two languages. So if you speak Hindi and I start speaking Nepali, you're listening to Nepali, what causes some problems? Well, the problem is the roots tend to be the same as the verbs. Okay, I have the root in red here. But Hindi uses the infinitive hona. When Nepali is pronounced huna. And there's two forms of this in Nepali. And it's used to conjugate. Okay, so Hindi only has one form of course, past tense and et cetera, et cetera. It's only like hu, he, he. But Nepali has also another form, which is used for descriptives and location, and also for conjugating verb, like ma Nepali bhasa bolchu, which means I speak Nepali. But in Hindi, that would be me Nepali bhasa bolta hu. You're using hu, okay? And in Nepali, you're using chu. So that's probably why the Hindi speakers listening to Nepali, all the verbs have this ending. So that, what is this cha chu? And also becomes. Well, look, it's huncha, huna, huncha. This is another form of it, too, which shows something that occurs often. So the Hindi people hearing this part, it makes no sense to them. So that's why listening to Pali, every single verb that's conjugated, huh? You know? So it throws them off, even though the roots are the same. Okay, so I'm just showing you the infinitives here. Hindi's sometimes a little bit more, in that sense, Nepali is more complicated. Hindi is more complicated in the fact that you have to inflect the verbs for masculine singular plural, feminine singular plural, okay? So you have na, ne, ni, ni, okay? So, for example, if you're just saying to do, okay? So masculine would be karta hu. If a man talking, a female saying about themselves would be karti hu. And then Nepali would just be garchu for that one. So you see this big difference with the... This sounds so different in that case. So that's what throws people off. Okay, here's just some greetings to show the difference. These two probably everybody know, right? Namaste. Namaskar is more polite. Same exact thing in Hindi. This is what I said to you at the beginning today. I said, Timilai Kosacho. Okay, so how are you? So, Apse kese hain. All right. It sounds somewhat different because, again, this cha and hey use. Ah, Malay samcha cha, tapalai ni, how are you? And then, may tik hu, aap se, or aap, sorry. Or what's your name? Tapai ko naam ke ho, aap ka naam kya hai? I have a hard time going between two languages, sorry. And then, thank you is the same, danyabad. Nice to meet you would be quite different. It would be tapalai bitre kushi lagyo. And then Hindi would be aap se mirke kushi hai. That's it, except I have one final video if you want to hear it. Yes? Okay. Nepali songs. Okay. Rap. Was that hard to, as a Hindi speaker, was that hard to understand? You're catching some words like yeah. That's it. Now, if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them, but you're probably tired of this. Anybody want to ask a question? Or do you want to go? It's up to you. Oh, yeah, okay. Another mic. If you want to go, please. I've held you too long. I'm really sorry it went over this far. I hope you enjoyed it. Yeah. What?
When did Vietnam introduce the Latin alphabet?
I think they introduced it in the 18th century, but they only dropped using it around 1912, I think. But dropped using the Chinese characters.
And when did Korea introduce its own alphabet?
1400 something. Yeah, 1443, I think it is. Yeah.